Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here, but he is risen. This is such a lovely story. And it feels utterly impossible. How can this be? How can it be? It's unbelievable. After the scandal of the cross, after the scandal of death, a humiliating death, a death just for criminals, the most preferred instrument of torture in the empire. After the expectations and hopes have been set aside forever, imagine how his disciples felt, those men, those 11, hanging out in that upper room. They have to be wondering a lot of things. What have we been doing for the last year of our lives? What did we pin our hopes on? Why did we bother with all of this? What's next for us? And most of all, I think, is the death of hope. Nothing is ever going to get better. We thought that this guy was it, that he was the king that would replace Herod, that he was the one that would overturn empire. He was the one who would get the Romans out of here once and for all, and finally there would be justice. We wanted justice, and we got suffering. Doesn't that just feel like a way? The thing about Easter is, you can't get there without the cross. It's so beautiful this morning. It feels like such a sour thing to start with such a dark note. It puts me in mind of a story that James Martin tells. James Martin is a Jesuit priest and an author, and he writes about his mother visiting her own mother at a nursing home and overhearing conversation of two other people there like you do when you go visit. It's an older nun, and she was being visited by the superior of her order, who was a younger woman. And the older nun was in a wheelchair. She was confined. It was painful. It's not good. And she was sharing her complaints with her superior, and the mother superior said, "Think of Christ suffering on the cross." The older nun regarded the younger one, and she replied, "Well, yeah, Jesus was only in agony for 3 days, though." You see, that younger woman, she wanted to be a source of spiritual comfort for the older one, to make meaning of the unbearable suffering that life under the degenerative disease can bring. He wanted to try and minimize the lived experience of the woman in the wheelchair by inviting her to compare her own suffering to the suffering of our Lord and draw the obvious conclusion that no one suffered as much as Jesus, and therefore we should not complain so much about our own suffering. Think of Jesus on the cross. I think the older nun was right to point out the obvious. Jesus' suffering, in fact, only lasted a matter of days. Her suffering will go on much longer. It's such a human tendency, isn't it, to want to try and help people by minimizing their own experience? Like, if we can reduce the idea of something in our minds, then we will suffer less. Buddhism, at its height, teaches that all suffering is illusion. Now look, I'm not here to knock Buddhism. There is deep wisdom in that practice, in places where Buddhism and Christianity come together in powerful ways, but as my mom would say, that conversation, that's another Oprah. For most of us, suffering is a big part of what's on the menu of everyday life. Every day, we're subject to the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune. And like Shakespeare's Hamlet, we've decided that we either have to fight back or just give up and accept it. Fight, flight. And that's where we find those disciples this morning, the men folk back at home hiding out. What's happening next? I can only imagine what they're thinking. But I can tell you one thing, they're not leaving that house. Fight? No, please. Don't take flight today. It just seems like the worst always happens. knocked down for no reason. Suffering is the thing that seems all too real. It's justice that feels like an illusion. So that's the men, but what about those women? Our text says that they went out early in the morning. The Greek word is the depth of darkness. I love that, the deep darkness. The dark before dawn. It's the kind of dark that puts me in mind of the darkness before God said, let there be light. That kind of darkness.
Put that down.
It's a darkness where all light seems absent and everything feels possible. They bought spices and other preservatives to take care of the body because they were present for the whole thing. They did what so many women do. They just witnessed the whole thing. They stood by. It's an unpleasant job, but it needed to be done. So they go, and I wonder what they were thinking as they walked toward that little tomb, borrowed from somebody else, hewn in rock. That stone was so big. How on earth are we going to move it away? Well, we'll figure that out when we get there, I guess. So you would imagine their surprise when they see that the stone is gone. When you go into our parish hall this morning, you can see that our director of children and youth, Sue, has created her own tomb. But the stone has been rolled away. On Friday, we walked through that with some of our children. And imagine what it would be like to go in there and find it empty, as the women did. The stone is rolled away and Jesus is gone.
This is paper.
And then, even more shocking, two heavenly beings, angels, I guess, show up in dazzling clothes. Let there be light. Let there be dazzling robes. And they say, why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen. Now, to say that this does not meet their expectations, I think, is a gross understatement. Because as scandalous as Jesus' death on a Roman cross was, this is, in many ways, way, way worse. Because if Jesus is not there, if he is in fact risen, what does that mean about anything? Because the experience of resurrection does not meet our expectations. This is what we expect. That the worst will happen. The bad guys will win. The good guys will suffer. Resurrection. What is that? And yet these women cannot deny the truth of their own experience. Experience There's nothing that I can say to you to convince you of anything that will contradict your own experience. All I can do is invite you to reflect on your own lived experience. So the women, what would they do? They hustle back. They don't stand on a street corner proclaiming it to strangers. They go back to their nearest and dearest. It's what any of us do when a good story happens, when something interesting and out of the ordinary happens to us. We go back and we say, oh my gosh. We would come to our group meeting at church. We would come to our family group, our bridge club, our colleagues, our peers, the people that we love and trust, and we say, gone. It's empty. And they respond to her by telling that her story is garbage. Our translation doesn't quite do justice to that little piece. This is an idle tale. Now, I don't have time this morning to get into kind of the casual sexism of saying that the women were gossiping with the phrase idle tale in the translation. Again, another but the word that is used there is leros. Leros. It said that her story was garbage. Worthless. Crap. The story of resurrection is crap. And yet, the lived experience of the women contradicts their lived experience of suffering.
Lazy.
What to do. This is where we are when we are living a resurrection life. There's nothing that we can say to one another to convince other people the reality of resurrection, because it is contrary to everything that everything else is telling us. Well, let me ask you, where have you experienced resurrection in your life? If you know someone or are yourself someone who is in recovery, you know what resurrection looks like. It defies all expectations of what life was supposed to be. This morning, we had the sunrise service down there at Hollow Park. And it was our church, Methodist Church, and the UCC Church just up the road, North Church. Three pastors, three different communities. In 2019, that doesn't seem like a very big deal. But as I walked back up the hill, walked by the grave of our first rector, John Rutgers Marshall, a guy who was regularly beaten up by the Congregationalists in town because he was not practicing the right religion. In fact, John Marshall died from complications of kidney failure for a beating that he took. I could just imagine telling John Marshall if I could get to sit down and meet him today. He celebrated the resurrection this morning with the Congregationalists up the road. And the Methodists, who were barely even a thing when you were alive. Resurrection. It's awesome. Not only that, resurrection, and this is the most scandalous part of all, is probable. How can I say that? How can I say that when there is so much about our lives that tells us that the opposite is true? It's almost offensive. And yet, our choice is to participate in resurrection life. We participate in resurrection life not because like to be saved, although that is certainly true. If Jesus died and rose again so that we would know life after death, that he would conquer death for all time, that would have been enough. That would have been plenty. But Jesus was not just about by and by, pie in the sky after we die. Resurrection life is here and now. And the truth is, scandalous truth is that resurrection is happening over and over again. Think about those times in your life when the worst was supposed to happen. Think about those times in your life when the worst happened and everyone came around you in love. What happens when we allow our suffering to be transformed, not compared, not minimized, but when our suffering is transformed? Resurrection does not happen the way that we want it to. It doesn't happen the way that we think we will. In other versions of our gospel, the women, again the women, don't even recognize Jesus at first. Are you the gardener? Who are you? Resurrection is a transformation. The hard truth is that we want things to be restored to the way they were before. We want resurrection to make everything back the way it was when everything was great. That's just not how it works. But in the resurrection life, we believe that things can be transformed even in suffering. That things can be transformed to a kind of new that we have never known before. Morning. I am right here. gospel, we see Peter. Peter. Boy, he's had a rough week, that guy. Denied Christ 3 times. Cut off the ear of the servant. Man, Peter just cannot get it right. But Peter is the one guy that recognizes the truth of what Jesus has said, or what the women have said. He says, I know you well enough to know that you're not just giving me a line of garbage. And he goes out to see for himself. Resurrection is not something that you can hear about and understand. It's the kind of thing where someone says, my life has been transformed. My life has been transformed by love. Go out and see for yourself. Happy Easter. Do not seek.